It's great. I can be here, okay, to talk about this topic. So thanks everyone, okay, for joining this session. It is from MySQL, and the topics today, as mentioned by folks, it is about how we deploy MySQL and in an easy way. And there are so many ways that we can do this deployment. And people has been doing this from time to time. Who am I? My name is Ivan Mar. I'm from Hong Kong. So I have been involved in this software deployment architectures, okay, over the last some years. And today is actually be the MySQL deployment topic. So let's go ahead and what's today. So the agenda is like, so what kind of deployments we have been seeing? Okay, it can be the master and slave, and today we use the terminologies called source and replicas. And there's also something to make it easy to deploy through the replica set. And it is a MySQL Shell, InnoDB Cluster, and doing this, and we will explain later. And there is also a very open and out-of-the-box deployment using the group replication, or we say that MySQL InnoDB Cluster. It is a very hot topic for this day. And how we bridge a production site and the DR with the InnoDB Cluster. That's what we today, we have the so-called cluster set. Okay, that is very helpful for us to like click, and then we can build the replication across two or more cluster. And people also telling they like the Kubernetes. So how does that work, okay, in MySQL deployment? So what today, I will also share, okay, the latest, okay, the preview of MySQL operator for this Kubernetes, as well as people like to see something in actions on cloud. So there is MySQL database service, and as well as the really hot topics, the machine learning for the heat wave, which it can be, you can find it on our Oracle cloud infrastructures. Okay, let's get into it. First of all, when we look at this diagram, so basically it is quite typical. It's like master and slave. People deploy applications and MySQL in just one standard, okay, as like standalone server, and getting a like standby server, okay, on the other machine or actually on the other site. So basically, this is like logical replications from one site, one MySQL, and sending data across the network to the target, which we call this replicas, or in the old terms, we call this slave. Master and slave in the old terms. And today we use source and replicas. That can happen to be with one-to-one, that can happen to one-to-many. So with this, what we are talking about is the applications connect, okay, through certain, okay, middle tier, okay, to connect to MySQL server. It can be the VIP, virtual IP. It can be something the third-party components, okay, like SQL proxy SQL or HA proxy, MHA, and something like this. Okay, that's the very basic, like how does the application can connect to the server and switch over to the other if that one fails. So for some incidences, if we fail over to another standby servers, which can be active, and afterwards, we want this server, okay, to get data back to the original server. We usually call this like dual replications. So the replications is unidirectional, but we can set up two, okay, from A to B as well as from B to A. So when we kickstart with the server on the machine B and the data which put onto the server B as the in the replicas at this at previous time, and now it becomes the primary and the source, and data can actually be replicated back to the original server. So when things happen, we need to switch back, we can get the primary server back to the original machine one server. So that's why we can actually have the like dual replications, okay, together. So there is also by default, when we talk about the replication, it is asynchronous. So let's look at on the right hand side, this actually is the source to sending data to the replicas. So it's actually, we call the semi-sync in here. So basically async, we may get data loss because the other side actually stopped. Okay, the data still continues to update. But what happens to this? We can enhance this, okay, to the so-called half and half, semi-sync. So in here at the bottom, we try to actually showing the state status, okay, or replica status in here. So the source is continuous per second, we update and insert a record. So in here, we have the GTID, and all this is actually data is written, okay, through the slave or the replicas. Now, the command we try is to stop the slave, okay, the IO which getting the data. So when we stop it, you see on the source, the data, okay, cannot be any more data to getting in. So it is just 1, 2, 3, okay? So on the other side, because we stop the way to getting data from the source, okay? Both sides at this time, we have the 1, 2, 3, okay, 123 rows of data. Now we try to start the IO again. So the IO continues to start again on the source. So that's why this actually protects the data. As like, okay, whenever we insert data, we guarantee the data has to go to the other side. Okay, so as on the left-hand side, the wordings in here is like, by default, replication setup is asynchronous. All this like transaction when it commits is just, okay, trying to write to the source bin log and then finish. But what happened, okay, if this is like the semi-sync, there is an IO thread on the replicas that try to pull the data from the source, being not dump thread, okay, to the release log. And the SQL thread is trying to apply that kind of data to the database, okay, from the relay log and sending back to the database. So application, okay, can actually read the data. So in this, like the demo on the right-hand side is trying to what? To stop this pulling data from the source, and the source cannot commit the data. So we guarantee whatever we commit the data at that point, okay, it has to commit to the relay, okay, data on the other side. Okay, there's no data loss. So the configuration and implementation has to get the semi-sync plugin on the master and as well as on the slave, or we call this replicas. And we have to enable the master and enable the slave. Okay, we can actually set like the timeout, where if the master on the source side, which tries to write and then it hang because the IO thread is stopped or whatever, the network is disconnected. So at that point, after the time out, it will bring the replications to asynchronous. As long as the connections get back, it will go into the semi-sync again, will tie to the IO thread again. So this guarantees the data has spontaneously to be written on the other side and no data loss. So what happened? Okay, any tools that we can actually make it easier, okay, is to enable this like replications. With the today, we have the MySQL Shell and InnoDB, which is the storage engine. And we can use this MySQL InnoDB ReplicaSet. And with this MySQL Shell, it is like a tool, it's a client, it's the CLI. So that we can use this JS JavaScript, okay, connects to the source, the host one, and then create a replica set, okay, named as MyRS. And we use this to add the second instance and as well as the third instance in here. So you can see this, okay, that kind of the creation using the shell is easy. And bring this all together, okay, forming a 1 to 2, okay, replications, okay, easily without getting like change master, all these things. This is just very simple in MySQL Shell and typing in a few commands. In here, you can see 3 command lines, okay, to bring these 3 instances to be a replica set, a replication architecture, okay. For sure, in here, the timing, okay, because there is, it is the asynchronous replications, data still maintained in the source, and the pulling data, okay, is something next step. So it is asynchronous. So there's a chance data is written on the server A may not be able to catch up into the server B and C. Okay, this is asynchronous. So this is tool. So what next? After we actually have the innovations to get into the InnoDB cluster deployment. So with this InnoDB cluster deployment, you can see, oh, we have the free MySQL server, which is the yellow color in here. And the application connects to something in the middle, which we call this MySQL router. So the MySQL routers is like a transparency tier. And the application connects this like a proxy server. And that proxy server will know where is the MySQL server active. So it connects transparently to the backend, the server, even if it's three nodes. So whatever that's bring down the server, it will actually switch over to the others. It's like failover, but the application is transparent. It doesn't know, it doesn't need to know. So this is kind of the deployment here. But people also may create another topology, which we have the routers just sitting on the server. And the applications, for example, this is like Java and JDBC URL, and it can get into the multi-host connections. And when it connects to the router, which the router one, it fails, it can connect to the router two. And the router one, two, three, basically they are stateless. Okay, no matter which one you are connecting to, it's actually connect to the topology of the three InnoDB cluster. So it knows where to talk to. So this transparency is getting very easy for deployment. So let's look at how we create this InnoDB cluster on this right-hand side. So firstly, we can actually provision three nodes. Okay, the very basic one from the fresh, clean, and newly created instances, which is the demo on the right-hand side. Okay, it is still blank. And there is possibility, people has been running a single node server, and they just want to add in two nodes, okay, to bring the server into HA, which we call this three node InnoDB cluster. Okay, it can be backup restore or whatever, MySQL dump and MySQL actually loading the data back. Or the other side is people has been doing the replications using master and slave, and this means they have the two nodes already and running with the data. So basically the two nodes, we assume all the data is exactly the same. And we provision another new node, okay, bring the data, okay, as like the replicas, so one to two and three nodes at that point, and then we can bring this to InnoDB cluster and config and create the administration users as well as config properly for the my.cnf, the configuration file. And for sure, when we say this actually a cluster, meaning the data in for all these nodes, they have to be the same. Same by what means? It is like all this, okay, we do not compare line by line, okay, data by data, okay, but we compare the GTID, global transaction ID, with A server, B server, and C servers to be all the same. That means, okay, they are the same data. So we have to guarantee, okay, all this GTID on all these servers to be the same so that they can bridge them together. And we provide this, okay, with the assumption, or actually it's a requirement. For all this table, we need the primary key to identify all specific rows, okay, to all the data. And so whenever we update a specific row, and we know where it is, and it can actually perform quickly. So the demo's right here on the right. So now, first of all, we create the three instances, okay? We call this the port number 3310, 3320, 330. And they, once we create, as pointed out in here, the three directory is actually the data directory. As the demo, we put this onto the one single box. So for this, the one single box creations, after this, you will see that, okay, we try to change the configuration my.cnf to append certain specific configurations, okay, like the repository table, GTID must be on, and also the checksum, okay, using what is the SCH64. So after all this, actually the very basic configurations, we can start it up. So once we start it up, so what the next is, so right now all this startup, that startup can be using the system D or whatever you feel it is good for you. So right now I'm using the tar package, which has the MySQL DSafe, and the 310.203.0 port number, okay, they are running. So for this, it's a brand new server. So the GT ID, that means they are all empty and they are all the same because they are just the same. So what's right now? I'm actually getting into the connections to the MySQL shell and then connects to the server. So what that is, it has the JavaScript, Python, SQLite. And what next is we create an administration users, GR admin users. And by configuring these users, we also check whether there is actually missing configuration. It does. Okay, the MySQL shell tries to configure the server and restart it if needed. So all the server is created properly and we check it. And what next is we log in through the MySQL shell, okay? And in here it's just to execute the select statements to query the GT ID. As mentioned earlier, they are brand new server, no transaction at all. Even we create the users, but it's actually hidden as like user transactions. So the GT ID is all empty, okay, for all the server, meaning they are all the same, okay? When the cluster is built, okay, it tries to compare. So what next is we tries to create this cluster by create cluster command. This command is, okay, we set certain parameters, consistency, how it detect the timeout, and also what's the cluster network and subnet. So all this together, and we create a cluster. So right now the cluster on the server one, which has, okay, a one node server as the cluster. And we try to add the second and third node, okay? Which is how we do this by recovery. It can be cloning, mentioned earlier in the last sessions, or it can be incremental. As right here, all this empty, they're the same. So we just use incremental, that's the fastest, okay? So to bring data here and back. So meaning there is actually no data changes at all. So we try to use this, and also it tries to use the local host and other port number where we try to use this as like the local cluster network. And as long as we do this, we actually create another node, which the cluster has two nodes, and we do this again for the third node, and we create this InnoDB cluster. Okay, so let's move on. So what about if we deploy this to the DR? There are some other alternative. So for one thing here is, we can create a cluster and cluster on two data center. And with this, meaning we have to send the data from one side to the other side. So we bridge this in through the async replications. So we can actually use the cluster sets. Okay, it's actually a new features, okay, out from the 8.0.27. And as of today, it is actually 8.0.28. So basically this like the replication connections, it has the failover capability, no matter this is on source or no matter this is on replicas. Meaning there should be actually like point-to-point connections. The point-to-point, when the point has outage, what happens? The point actually on one side, we have three nodes. Okay, one of these fail, it actually fails to the other. So the source data will actually be another node to sending data across. And the same way apply. Okay, the same way applies to the replica side. Meaning we have one node actually on the replica side on that data center is receiving data, but what happened is fails. So it also will fail back, fails to the other nodes receiving the set of the data and bring the data in always, okay, available. So it can be just two data center, or in the middle, we can be three data center, okay, or four. So this is like the replications can actually be scaled to multiple data center. And one important thing is there is maybe a chance the data center does not have, okay, that much capacity. We may actually host just one single node InnoDB cluster as like standby, okay, because we have sufficient, okay, power for the data center one and two, so we don't need extra more, and that's actually just for something as like backup. Okay, so that's what we call this cluster set. It is quite easy. So right now, as actually the demo on the right-hand side, we have, okay, the 10.203.0 as cluster as we built earlier. And then now we try to extend this to actually 5.0 and 6.0 and with the two cluster, assuming they are actually sitting on two VM or sit actually on two data center. So what's right now, you can see right now, when you look at this, so basically you can see this. We try to create the three nodes, okay, 4, 5, 6 as brand new, or we can actually back up and recovery. And now we start the 4, 5, 6 and again, and what next is we try to get into the create replica set. So what this means, we create a replica set is, we use this, okay, to create a replica set, okay, as you can see, we run this, create replica set, and that actually works. And what next is to query the status, what happened to this replica set? We try to get the replica set, cluster set, which is, and the status is showing there's one cluster to this cluster set. Okay, and the primary instance is 51.0. What next is we create the 3v4.0 as the second cluster, okay, replica. So in here, you can see we create this replica and now, and my cluster 2 is up and running. Okay, the 3v4.0 as well as, and with this, my cluster 2, we can just do it the same way, okay, to add the instance, and all this together, meaning we have two cluster, okay, by having this MySQL shell and the deployments is just easy, and the two data center is now bridged, okay, together. So we have the command to show the cluster again, and it will show you they are actually two cluster running. So you can see this actually, my cluster is the primary, my cluster 2 is the replicas. And they both have three nodes running. Okay, so what next? Here, somebody may actually ask, what happens to the right now people using Kubernetes? So as Kubernetes right here, I will just do it quick. So the three nodes actually, we can easily to create a stable set and actually the router set. And there is actually custom resource definitions, putting the InnoDB cluster as the resource in Kubernetes. And there's also service, okay, which we can deploy as a name, say my cluster, which point to, okay, the router tier, actually this is the status replica set. Okay, so whatever, which one is failed, it actually automatically points to the others and the application is transparently to access the routers, okay, through the service. So this is more detailed, okay, diagram and showing in the MySQL operators, which you can install and perform all this operation, which is quite easy. And with all this, like how we do backup as well. Okay, so what it means to us is this actually operators is now in beta and you can actually find it in the github.com MySQL operators. You can easily deploy this, okay, CLD, custom resource definitions, and as well as deploy operators YAML, which you can find it on the operators. There's also Helm chart. Okay, if you look at this operators, okay, page, you will see how we can actually install in another way, use Helm chart. So here, I just to show you using the kubeadmin, okay, is to deploy kubectl. So basically, I have this like the our Kubernetes environments, okay. So with this Kubernetes environments, so what next is we can actually have this web page, and there is actually a way you can copy. And you can deploy this to here and run it, script control apply that specific CLD as well as the other YAMLs deploy the operators. When we deploy the operator, meaning there is also a namespace called MySQL operators running, and we can use that, okay, to deploy our custom resource, which it is IC InnoDB cluster. Okay, so once we have this, we actually have this namespace and the port is running. So right now, on the screen, it is trying to show you there is a new namespace and the one is actually being deployed and for some seconds, and we will see that it is running and it's ready. So let's get it, okay, quickly to another one, how we deploy InnoDB cluster with that deployed operators. So let's get to this step, okay. So here you can see that firstly, we need to get to the username password for the MySQL database. So we define a secret. Okay, by applying the secret with the name, my password, okay, my REST users and password welcome one. And what after this is to apply for sure. And then we deploy the InnoDB cluster by having the YAML, and the kind is the InnoDB cluster. Okay, the type of the resource is InnoDB cluster. Okay, it is something new, which is the operator. When we deploy, we create the CLD, which has a new name, InnoDB cluster. And right now in here, we actually get a name, my password for the resource about the username password, and three instances for the nodes. We can actually spawn 5, 6, whatever. And also the routers, how many actually we need that. And also three, and we may actually change time zone from specific, okay, the US time zones back to something else. And we actually can enable some other configurations as well as the storage, how big your storage size you need to. So once we do all this, the things is we provision, okay? And provision getting to time and around 2 minutes, and it has one server running and another minute. So after around this like 7 minutes, we get to the MySQL server up and running in a very easy way. So you can see this, the InnoDB cluster with this is actually up and running now. All this actually you can see my cluster online, three online, and it has three instances and routers actually three, and the ages actually over like 5, 6 minutes, okay, all provisioned, okay, in my specific environment. So you can see onward, we can deploy applications to access and actually get to know how we can access to it. So let's get it easier and then start it for like how we deploy PHP and Mint, for example. So in here, so you can see we have the cluster up and running. We can scale it, okay, by obviously we have three nodes and we add it and then change the number of instances from 3 to 5. And after this, we apply and then we get 3 instances and getting to 5 instances. Okay, it's still in the process of provisioning additional one online. So after a while, we actually see this. Okay, my cluster is getting more and more and 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4, 5. Okay, 4. And the cluster servers is there. So what next is we actually provision the PHP. Okay, the PHP admin can actually be running and connecting to us. So what in here is we actually provision the PHP admin, and the PHP admin can actually be running easily, and then we just wait for the load balances, the external IP, or we can use the ingress, okay, controller, and then have the ingress rules, and to make sure that the routing from the externals to the Kubernetes to be up and running. So after that, we can actually use the PHP admin and connect things to the InnoDB cluster. Okay, next, let's move on. So having said that, HA, the high availability with this, meaning we can have the single, okay, we do our own with the InnoDB cluster, okay, or we can use the Kubernetes, okay, MySQL operators, as well as what about the next game is, okay, on cloud, MDS. So let's get a quick look on what is available on our Oracle Cloud infrastructures. We can provision a standalone service as a click-a-click, as well as we can define HA models, which is the three nodes running as like, you know, the good replications running, as well as a high performance and very speedy. Okay, we call this heat wave. And we have today machine learning enabled for this heat wave as well. So we have different shape, okay, to accommodate the requirements of the users. Okay, what they want for this. And it's managed servers and applications around in the, on the OCI will actually be created and easily be used. So as the many data center, okay, even on the cloud, we need to be fault tolerance. And what it means in here, a machine or a data center, we have availability domain, we have the fault domain with the machine. So we deploy when we click the HA models, meaning the node actually deploy a specific machine or a specific data center. When the region has more than one data center, they will try to deploy is across data center within the region. So we make sure that we get maximum reliability in here. So what about heat wave in here? So as managed server, MDS is like, okay, you provision it, you can use, okay, we have the people, we have the service automatic, we have the interface that you manage, you can actually monitor the MySQL database service as actually we see that earlier from our previous speakers. And the heat-based service right here, it can be the online database and just running the MDS, MySQL database service, and it's just write data to InnoDB. And the HeatWave is actually a cluster of memory engine and intelligence to actually dictate the SQL statement. And all data actually from the InnoDB can actually patch into this memory cluster. And data will be very speedy, to correspond to this SQL engine. So it can be the OLAP applications running and with the single interface. So in the past, people actually doing ETL, doing a lot of things, different databases, skill set, ETL, effort, all this, meaning the cost to you. So right now, with this single interface as SQL and MySQL as the frontier, to your application, meaning it's simplified. No ETL, again, your application is like the same skill set, running this and perform much, much faster. It can be extreme fast, 400, 5,000 times faster than the original what you are running, with your applications. What today we have machine learning applications to be enabled. So think about this. As heat wave machine learning, meaning, in the past, you may use Zeppelin, Jupyters, running pandas, and actually extract the data and then and put it into somewhere, and you have to use the training data and finding what actually predictions, and you want to explain and infer, to the end result. Just like, we have all this like travel and things. We want to find the shortest path, to somewhere. How we can do this? We learn from the experience and then we project, this may be the shortest path, and then we find and explain what kind of attributes in your model should be good enough. So our MySQL HeatWave is here, also give you the capability to run this, in just SQL interface, SQL interface, This is like the first part, for us to explain. We have this. I hope today is about time, for the sessions. And this gives you a summary for today. And see if you have any questions for today. We have the easy deploy, for MySQL. It can be the source replicas, ReplicaSet, and InnoDB cluster, as well as running on the Kubernetes. As well, I explain for others like how we do this, the MySQL database service, as well as HeatWave and machine learning. And the shell, which is actually today, we use this actually can be to supervision, can be actually migrations, tools.